Good evening. I'm Reverend Bob Phillips, filling in for the month of August for Pastor Rachel Gilmore at the gathering at Scott Memorial United Methodist Church. Pastor Rachel, as many of you know, is on study leave for the month, so she asked her old man to come out of retirement and cover the bases, look for fresh sin while she's gone, which I'm always happy to do. We continue the series on You Asked For It, different kinds of subjects that folks from the congregation have asked be the subject of a sermon. Now, oftentimes you can also subtitle series like this, Controversies for Cranky Christians, because when you have subject-based preaching, there's always the risk that what you'll get mostly is the Reverend's opinion on stuff, whether or not it's actually connected to anything related to the Bible. Of course, Pastor Rachel's not like that, but it can be a professional risk in general. And so I begin this message with a reminder of a couple of scriptures that help lay the foundation and set the parameters for any such series of messages on controversial subjects. In Jeremiah chapter 37, we have the account where King Zechariah goes to the prophet Jeremiah and asks him simply, is there any word from the Lord, in response to a crisis that was brewing? Is there any word from the Lord remains a very relevant statement to ask when dealing with controversial issues. Related to that, in John chapter 12, we have a number of people that went to the apostle Philip, and these guys said to Philip, sir, we want to see Jesus. That's the other half of the equation. We want to see Jesus. I know what my cut is on any particular issue. You probably know what your cut is. But did Jesus have a cut on things? Did he deal with whatever subject is we are facing? Or through his teaching and example, are there insights that can be brought to bear? For after all, he is Lord. If we don't do this, we wind up simply filling the air with our own opinions. And that leads to one of my favorite verses in all the Bible, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 2. It really belongs in cross stitch on every room in every church building where committee meetings are held. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 2, a fool does not delight in understanding, but only in erring his opinion. Well, we're going to move beyond that today in looking at the subject of euthanasia. What does the Christian faith say about euthanasia? Well, it's simple to say what the Bible says about euthanasia. Specifically, nothing. The word's not found in the Bible. No one in the Old Testament or the New Testament engaged in euthanasia, which is mercy killing. That's the technical meaning of the word. Now, there's a good reason, practically speaking, why mercy killing, as we know it today, was not practiced in biblical times, to our knowledge, certainly not within Judaism or Christianity. The life expectancy in those days was approximately 25. Now, much of that was due to the fact of a huge infant mortality rate, but people didn't live a long while. That's the reason why you find in the Psalms and elsewhere in Scripture a reminder that when someone with gray hair enters a room, you really should stand up in respect, because there's so few of them around. Well, that was then. I'm now, and so are a number of you. So it is today we find that the subject of mercy killing or euthanasia comes to play primarily when we're looking at a situation where a person is ill, they are going to die, there is no hope for recovery, they're in tremendous pain, they want to die, and yet they are not legally permitted to be put out of their pain by others. Now, we're not talking here about assisted suicide, which is a related but a separate subject. We are talking about the active participation of those in the medical profession or other family members who take specific steps to end the life of their loved one, of their patient, of their friend. Now, within Scripture, we do find a good deal of guidance to set the stage. In Genesis chapter 1, which would be the text for today, again, you would find in the story of creation. At the pinnacle of creation, God creates man in his own image. In the image of likeness created he him, male and female created he them. This in Genesis chapter 1. Man, generically speaking, humankind as male and female. Then in Genesis chapter 2, you find the story retold from a somewhat different but complementary theological perspective, in which God forms man out of the dust of the earth and breathes into his nostrils the breath of life, and man becomes a living being. Life is a gift of God. Life is the intention of God. And every one of us who possess life do so because our Heavenly Father, our Creator, has intended that it be so. We find elsewhere in Scripture, whether through the Ten Commandments or other places, numerous other places, and Jesus certainly reinforces this, the commandment, "You shall not kill," which literally interpreted in these passages are, "You are not to murder someone. There is to be no wanton taking of a life." And there are folks that argue, and very sincerely so, that euthanasia is not murder. It's not like robbing a bank and shooting the teller. It's not like torture. It's not like genocide or these other horrible kinds of acts. But indeed, euthanasia is an act that can be undertaken out of a deep sense of love and care for the suffering of another. So along with the biblical reminder that all life, human life, is intended, that it is a gift of God, and that as we find in the book of Job, it is God who gives and the Lord who takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Along with that, we have this broader tendency in Scripture, and certainly in the ministry of Jesus, of the way we treat each other while we're alive and while we're all fighting the good fight. Paul writes, for example, in Ephesians, "And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you." We find, "Do not grow weary in well-doing," in Galatians, "for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. So that as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, and especially to those who are of the household of faith." And we find Jesus taking the words of the Shema in the book of Deuteronomy, adding to that other words from Leviticus, and giving us what we call now the great commandment, to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and our neighbor as ourselves. And so the question boils down to, is it possible to love someone deeply and as a result of that love, to take their life or to arrange for their life to be taken medically as the result of, for example, a serious illness that will kill them anyway and that has them in terrible pain? Well, here's where a reality check happily can intervene. And the reality check is this. I have a good friend, a physician who stood up the hospice operation and facility in Peoria, Illinois, the Richard Owens facility as part of the OSF, Order of St. Francis Hospital there in Peoria. He is very filled with knowledge and background in terms of issues related to hospice care. And we had a good conversation once after a young woman in her late 20s decided to move to a state where her life could be ended because she had brain cancer. And she knew she was going to die anyway, and she didn't want to linger in suffering. And this frustrated my physician friend, both because of his larger experience in hospice care and in what's called palliative care, the management of pain, and because both he and I had another friend who was also a physician, who at that moment was dying from the very same kind of illness affecting this young woman. What my friend had to say, and what I saw played out time after time in my connection with the hospice and with hospitals in general over many years, what I saw play out was this. The pain element really can be managed in virtually every situation. Thankfully, medicine has moved to a point where persons do not need to suffer horribly and consistently from whatever illness. And if they do, by golly, get yourself another doctor, because the possibilities for alleviating and dealing with pain are certainly there and available. And so my friend's opinion as an active and practicing Christian was, you don't need to end your life. You don't need to end the life of another person for that reason. Give them the chance to make the most out of whatever life remains. Care for them lovingly, compassionately. Do not end their life. Leave that in the hands of God. Now, that is basically an expression of the traditional and classical approach. I know that there are individual situations that can arise that can cause people to question that and to wonder, well, in this case, this is different, that is different. What does a Christian do? And so I simply leave you with this. When you are dealing with a situation, say in your own family or for someone whom you know who is facing especially critical illness, a life-ending kind of illness, and the subject of euthanasia or mercy killing or just how one's life is going to end is no longer a matter of theory but is becoming very real. In situations such as this, here is where the resources of our faith can take hold. In prayer for one another, in inviting and asking prayer from the family of Jesus, the body of Christ, the church, for that person, for those involved with that person, for the family, for the physicians and nurses and all who are involved in care. Prayer for wisdom and the presence of the Holy Spirit to guide those who are involved in decisions, those who are offering such care. In asking the helpful, not the intrusive questions, particularly if there have been issues of ongoing pain, if a person is unable to have any kind of stability and only knows pain, again, to ask as a loving outsider those kinds of questions that may indeed bring other kinds of help into the situation. And no matter what, never to withhold love. Love for the person in their illness, love for the person and their family in any question they might ask or any option they might entertain, whether you would agree with it or not, to love the person in their pain, no matter what. So as you will see in what I have just said, there is no the answer to this particular issue. There is the baseline of going to Christ, asking, is there any word from the Lord? From that we see God is the author of life. He is the only one rightly to remove what he has given us. And that in making the most of the kind of life God has given to each of us, we are called to do what sustains and enriches the abundant life that Jesus said he came to give. That involves our physical dimension for sure, but it also involves every aspect of who we are, physically, spiritually, emotionally, across the board. Choosing life, even in the midst of death, is an act of resurrection faith. And as we make that kind of choice, we will find our risen Lord walking beside us every step of the way. I'm Reverend Bob Phillips. The gathering at Scott Memorial United Methodist Church. See you in church.